Ephesians 4:20-24. That, however, is not the way you learned to live when you heard about Christ and were taught in him in accordance with the truth that's in Jesus. Now, what in the world is he talking about? Well, we're picking up in the middle of a thought. And he's been telling us what the nature of the non-Christian is like. And he says, you're not like that. He says, you were taught with regard to your former way of life to put all your old self, which is being corrupted by its deceitful desires, into being new in the attitude of your minds, to put on the new self created to be like God in true righteousness and holiness. So what we want to do is we want to look at this and begin to understand in more detail what's involved in it. Now, we've been seeing the kind of life the non-Christian lives, and we saw that in Ephesians 4:17-19. And there's phrases here, and they are absolutely amazing phrases. And one of the things a number of you have said to me, John, this has been such a help to me to understand why my non-Christians friends act the way they do. Because this is so explanatory when it comes to that piece, especially people you love and care for, family members, for example. Now, I want you to understand, this is very insulting. Listen to these words. They're futile in their thinking, darkened in their understanding, separated from the life of God, ignorant due to the hardening of their hearts, given over to sensuality so as to indulge in every kind of impurity and are full of greed. Now, those are not complimentary phrases. Now, the thing that's so amazing is the scripture says that every one of us were characterized by those traits before God gave us spiritual birth. And the degree to which we understand that is the degree to which we as Christians are going to live in the joy and victory of who God is. We've begun to see the contrast to those traits, that we are a new creation of God. And what he's done, it has changed all of those characteristics. We now are not deceived in our minds, deluded in our minds, futile in our minds. We have the very mind of Christ. The Spirit inspires our ability to desire and understand the things of God, and God lives in us. Because we've been given a new heart, we know and love the things of God, and we live for the glory of the Father. What a radical difference between those two lists of things. Now, these things being true, these traits that are called the new creation, what kind of people ought we to be? It's amazing when you look across the history of the world, the contrast between Christian people and non-Christian people. I saw that in a very unusual way for me when I was in Peru with Bible translators in the 60s. And I've shared with some of you, I had the privilege of rooming with a headhunter. Any of you ever done that? Tahiti was the chief of his tribe, a brilliant man, uneducated by our terms, but nonetheless a brilliant man. And I got to talk to him through a translator. He talked about what his life was like before he came to know Christ. And the major characteristic of it is they offered their infants to the boa constrictor because they were convinced that the boa constrictor was God. But you see, that's no different than the idols that the non-Christian follows and worships. Scripture talks about we have been made new in the attitude of our minds. Now, every once in a while, I get kind of dizzy headaches. I have one of those today, and my mind doesn't work quite right when I get these, so if I stammer and stumble along, you'll know what's going on. We don't know what causes it. It's just something I've lived with most of my life. But God has made us new in the attitude of our mind. Now, I love that phrase. It's not just new in our minds, in the attitude of it. Now, you know what attitude is in an airplane? Not altitude. Attitude. That's whether you're flying upside down or not. And there is in a plane a thing called an attitude indicator. I have one in my office. I should have brought it down today. And what it is, it's a little airplane that is on a swivel, and if the plane is going this way, it shows the plane is going that way or upside down. Scripture says we've been made new in the attitude of our minds. Now, as a result of that, he says there are certain things that should be happening. The first thing he says is we ought to put off something. And what put off means is stop doing, stop making accommodations for, refuse to give yourself to this activity. That's what put off means. Stop. Now, we're going to see the put on side shortly. We're not going to focus on that today, but at least so you know the balance. Put on means to start doing, make accommodation for, refuse to neglect this activity. So you see the two sides of the coin. God says there's certain things you should stop doing, and there's certain things you should start doing. And for every put off, there is one for one put on, and vice versa. So for everything God says to stop do, he has another one over here that says you should start to do, and vice versa. So it's important to realize here that this putting off and putting on is something we must do. It's not something that's done for us. Now, there are certain things in the Christian life we wait on the Lord to do for us. We cannot give ourselves spiritual birth. Only God can do this. This action he's talking about is something he's called us to do. Now, please notice this. You're going to say, what are you saying, John? This is not something we pray about. It's something we do. And the reason I say this, because I think a lot of times we sit back and we pray for things waiting for something to happen when God's saying, get off your spiritual behind and do something. And that's what he's talking about here. This is not let go and let God. It's take hold and claim what God has promised for you. This is action. Stop doing and start doing. This is very simple, straightforward, and you'll see this as the weeks go forward. It gets very specific about what we're to stop and to start. So the first one is in Ephesians 4:25. And we'll just begin to exhaust this a little bit today. He says, therefore, because we are new creations in Christ, each of you must pray about falsehood. Would you check your Bibles, please? Is that what it say? No, it doesn't say that. It says, therefore, each of you must put off falsehood. There's no praying about this. This is action. We do this. Now, in the doing, you pray. But we don't sit back and pray, we do it. Put off falsehood and put on speaking truthfully to your neighbor. Do you see the two sides? You're going to find if you see one, there's always the other one. Put off, put on. Anyone who has been stealing must steal no more, but work. And he says, ultimately become a giver. There is no can't in the Christian life. And we say this all the time. Well, I can't do that. That's not language that the Christian can legitimately use. The only thing we can say is, I won't, or I don't know how. Now, you need to recognize anytime you say, I can't, you're violating what Scripture has to say. Scripture says, yes, you can. You are to put off and put on. So it's either I won't, or I don't know how if I'm not doing that. 1 Peter 1:3-4. His divine power has given us a few things we need. Now, I still have people who are a little bit taken back when I misread Scripture. You guys have got it down pretty well. Are you struck by the word everything? You see, the reason I do this misread stuff on purpose is because it's so stunning that he says everything. His divine power has given us everything we need for life and godliness. What's that mean? We have everything we need for life and godliness. Now, do you ever feel like you don't? I think most of us would say there have been times in our lives when we did feel that way. We felt alone. We didn't know what to do. Things were awful. We struggled with that. Everything for life and godliness. Now, how does that come? He says, through our knowledge of him. Now remember in verse 18 of Ephesians 4, it says the ignorance that is in them. The non-Christian will never have the knowledge of him within them. This is because of the new birth that this is true. Who called us by his own glory and goodness, through these he has given us his, and I love this, very great and precious promises, so that through them you might participate in the divine nature, having escaped the corruption of the world caused by evil desire. Now friends, does that series of verses mean anything to you at all? As you think about your reactions to things over the last week or so, were there times when you totally ignored that? God had given me everything I needed, his very great and precious promises. I've told you before, but it's worth repeating. One of my friends used to say, quit praying your problems. Start praying the promises. That is very good counsel. In 2 Peter chapter 1, verses 5 to 11, he says, for this reason, what reason is that? Well, what we just read, that God has given us everything we need for life and godliness. For this reason, pray. Trust. Abide. Seek. Is that what it says? Any of those words appear there? Not one of them. Not one of those words appear. For this reason, make every effort. Now let me go back. I want to make sure you understand. For this reason, pray, trust, abide, seek. Most of us would put one of those words here. That's not what he says. They're all not there. He says what? Make every effort. So we are, as Christians, entirely too passive. God's calling us to give energy to this. He says, make how much effort? What does that mean? It means you got all you got. Give everything you have to this. To add to your faith, goodness, knowledge, self-control, perseverance, godliness, mutual affection, and love. So God says, give yourself to these put-on items. Therefore, make every effort to confirm your calling and election. For if you do these things, you will never stumble. Now that's kind of striking when you think of our age. The older we get, the more we're prone to stumble, right? At least physically. Scripture says, it's a promise. If you do these things, you'll never stumble spiritually. So how do we put off that which God tells us we should get rid of? Well, number one is we must remember who and what we are. Now, this sounds so incredibly simple, but it works. I've told you many times when I was a boy growing up, the last phrase I heard as I walked out the door is Mom and Dad said, John, remember who you are. I can't tell you how many times that kept me out of trouble, because I did not want to bring dishonor to them. And I could easily see that where this other group of people were going would have done that, and I wanted nothing to do with them. It was very easy for me to stand alone. In our culture, this is a huge piece. You might pray for me, by the way, on Wednesday night. I'm going to talk to the junior hires. Got to talk a few weeks ago to the high schoolers. That went just really well. I'm going to talk to the junior hires a little bit on Wednesday night. One of the things I want to talk to them is about this. How do you not follow the crowd? How do you not do that? You remember who you are. Ephesians 4, 20 to 22 says this is who we are. That, however, is not the way of life you learned when you heard about Christ and were taught in him in accordance with the truth that's in Jesus. You were taught to put off your old life. So Scripture is calling us to not live what we used to be. We need to learn how to give the Word of God authority in our lives. Sadly, we listen passively to so many other voices. I wonder if we played back a recording of your life this last week. I wonder how many voices really impacted you solemnly. How much of it was scripture based? How much was based on something else? Just as an example, as you're reading about the remake of the Obama healthcare, is there any fear at all in your mind that somehow or other that will impact you negatively? Well, we don't know, do we? But are you fearful about it? We begin by asking ourselves, where does this thought come from? Now, I meet with people a lot, and I love doing that. I love counseling with people from the Word. And one of the things I'm always asking them is to take their thoughts captive. And how do you do that? I say, where is this thought coming from? So you read about the United Nations and their attack on Israel, and you say, oh my goodness, it's all over. It looks like Israel's going to be done away with. And that is the implication of that position, by the way. Is that what's going to happen? No. God has promised that his promise to Israel will be fulfilled. Every thought we ever have will come from one of a few places: the world, the flesh, the devil, or the Lord and his word. And so the very first thing we have to do when we have a thought is to say, where did that thought come from? There's a couple of them, but there is one particularly satanic intersection. You know where it is? It's at Hawthorne and PCH. And it sees me coming, and it loads up the turning lane with cars so I can never go through it the first time. I know, there's this big camera. Have you never seen it? It's called the John Thiel camera, and it obviously loads it up so I can never go through the first time. And you know why? Because some idiot in the front line waits a long time before they start. And Ruthie will tell you this week, I told somebody off. Quite a few cars back. There's been a couple of you who've said to me, John, don't tell us those stories. You should be improving. I am improving. I just have a long ways to go yet. Now, you know where those thoughts come from when I'm stuck in that left turn pocket? They're coming from the world, the flesh, and the devil. And the Lord would say, John, haven't you learned the blood draw story yet? Learn how to let me write the agenda of your life. Now, I don't know what it's like for you. It's probably far more serious than a left turn lane, but you get the idea. And we say these things and we have these feelings. Do we ever ask ourselves, where is this coming from? No, we don't. We just passively let it happen. We must learn how to question, is this God's truth or a lie that sets itself up against the knowledge of God? And I've always loved the word a pretension. 2 Corinthians 10, 3-5, a pretension that sets itself up against the knowledge of God. You know what a pretension is? Something that pretends to be what it's not. Something that sets itself up against God, pretending to be stronger than he is. We must learn how to bring God's truth up against the lie and demolish it. Now, I don't know what the lies are you believe this week. In one sense, it would be nice if we knew some of them so we could so particularly address them. But I know that in a group this size and the length since we were last together, every one of us have believed a number of lies from the world, the flesh, and the devil. And every one of them have robbed them of our victory, robbed us of our joy, robbed us of opportunity to minister. And God says we must take every thought captive. How do you do it? You remember who you are. Number two, we must remind ourselves of the character of the old nature. It says it is being corrupted by its deceitful and evil desires. It's ignorant, given over to sensuality, so as to indulge in every kind of impurity. It's futile and darkened, and most of all, it's separated from the life of God. So if those things are true, why would we want anything to do with it? Why would we live with any support at all to the old nature? It's like wearing a dead body on your back and living with it. Now, there was a story back a few months ago told about the apartment buildings right here on the corner, Western and Palos Verdes Drive North, and they discovered a body inside the wall. You remember that? Had been there for years. This lady disappeared, somebody murdered her, and built her into the wall. And you wonder, how in the world could they not have recognized the smell of that for a while? I mean, you just wonder what they did there. Would you do that? Would you go over to Green Hills, dig up a body, and bring it into your house and just let it sit on the couch? You see, that's what we do when we allow the old nature to rule our lives. We're taking that something that's dead and decaying, and we're hanging on to it. How hard is it to dissect something that's so evil and putrefied? Well, that's part of the problem, you see, is we don't see the old nature for what it really is. We embrace it. We make room for it. We don't see it for what it is. And Scripture says that old nature, what we were before that we're to get rid of, has nothing good for us. Number three, if we remember that we what we are and what we are not any longer, why would we want to live like what we were? It's like digging out your old rotten clothes from the garbage and wearing them again when you have a closet full of very nice clothes to wear. Now, that's one of the danger of a demented person, is they don't know how to separate what's good and bad, what's new and old. And as we get older, that's kind of what we do sometimes. We get so used to the patterns that we function with that we just stay with them, even if they're not doing good things. One of the ladies who was one of my clients, lovely lady, her handyman ripped her off for $750,000 that I can prove. I have him in prison. That was a joyous day. But you know why he did? She didn't understand what he was doing. He learned how to play the game with her, just the same old thing. He gave her another bill, and she didn't remember paying it, so she'd pay it again. Well, that's the way it is with the old nature. We don't take it captive. We let it rule and reign in us. Philippians 1:27, whatever happens, conduct yourselves in a manner worthy of the gospel of Christ. Or Ephesians 4:1, I urge you to live a life worthy of the calling you have received. Or 4, 2, and 3, be completely humble and gentle, patient, bearing with one another in love, make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. What is this all about? It's recognizing who we really are and giving every effort to it. Both the why and the what of what we put, why we are to put off these things is right here. So is the Lord convicting me of something I'm to put off? And what's the reason I would do to do it? Let me give you an example. In Ephesians 4:29, it says, do not let any unwholesome talk come out of your mouth, but only for what is helpful for building others up. I wonder, as you think about your language this last week, were there any things you said that were not helpful for building others up according to their need? I must admit, I did not ask the Lord to bless the driver in the left turn lane at Hawthorne Boulevard. Could I have done that? Yes. If I had taken every thought captive, would I have done that? Yes. One man said it this way, them things don't belong to Christians. And yet we make room for them over and over again. Romans 12, verse 2. Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. You already have the new mind. Scripture says, now let it transform your behavior. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is. His good, pleasing, and perfect will. It's a particularly great concern for me that so many people who call themselves Christians are just like the world. And Scripture says we cannot live that way anymore. We are to put off what we were and put on what we are now. Ephesians 5:8-12, you were once darkness. But now you're light in the Lord. Live as children of light, for the fruit of the light consists in goodness, righteousness, truth, and find out what pleases the Lord. Have nothing to do with the fruitless deeds of darkness, rather expose them. A fourth way we put off the old man, the old nature, is by making no room for it, having nothing to do with it, exposing the lie that it's based on, and the consequences of not doing so. I've told you the story, and it's kind of funny, but we can relate to it, about the man who's trying to lose weight. We've been addicted to donuts, and he loved them so much. And he said, I'm not going to have donuts anymore, but I'm going to drive in the neighborhood of the donut store because it makes me feel good. And the next couple of days, he said, you know, I'm going to go park in the parking lot of the donut house because I so much love the smell coming from the donut house, but I'm not going to go in. 2 days later, he says, I'm going to park in the parking lot. I'm going to walk into the donut house. I'm going to sit in those nice seats there where they're waiting. I'm not going to order anything. I'm just going to sit there. I'm going to look at the donuts. I'm going to smell the donuts. Well, you know what's coming next. A couple of days later, he's eating donuts. You see, that's how it is with us in all these matters. We play games with them. We're passive about it. And sin is not something to fool around with. It will get us. We must expose the nature of the old man to ourselves. There is even a sense when we need to speak the word of God to ourselves. We need to tell ourselves, David said it really well. He said, soul, what's wrong with you? We need to be talking to ourselves about these things. Ephesians 5:3, but among you there must not even be, whoops, a hint. I wonder how many hints there is of the old nature about us. And we wink at it. There's a man who I really love. Jerry's with the Lord now. Jerry Bridges, written a lot of books, great books. Anything by him you read is super. But he wrote a book called Respectable Sins. That in the Christian community, we make allowances for these things. Now, we don't make allowances for sexual sins usually. And it's interesting to me that the church has made such a big deal of sexual sin when God ranks all of them together. Gossip, worry, anxiety, speaking badly of one another, all those things are all lumped together with all the sexual sins, but those are the acceptable ones, you see. I have always been prone to worry. I can give a great excuse. Russia made me do it. You didn't get the pun of that. No, we can always blame it on somebody else. Worry, you see, is a choice. Now, I can tell you that my grandfather was a worrier, my mom was a worrier, and so I'm a worrier. And there are such a thing as generational sins, where you see these things going. So there's a propensity on that side of my family to be a worrier. But what does God say? Put it off. Don't pray about it. Don't excuse it. Put it off. It's amazing to me to see how simple it really is. Not even a hint, he says. Romans 13:13-14. Let us behave decently, as in the daytime. Not in sexual immorality and debauchery, not in dissensions and jealousy. Rather, clothe yourselves with the Lord Jesus and do not think about how to gratify the desires of the flesh. I wonder this last week, how much time have you spent thinking about the things that God says you ought to get rid of? This is particularly interesting to me because when I had my elder care company, I dealt with a lot of hoarders. Now, we could even have a hoarder or two in here, I don't know. Hoarder in the extreme. Some of the clients I had, you could not even get in the house. There was one in Pasadena, I'll never forget. You opened the front door, and all you would see is a small opening just above your shoulders where you could crawl in a little bit. You crawled over all kinds of stuff back in the back corner of the house. There was just enough room to have a bed, and it was surrounded by all this stuff. It was unbelievable. Now, may I suggest to you that many of us are old nature hoarders. We've been storing all these old nature habits for so long, they're still in our house. Oh, we have a little corner back in the room somewhere where we have a new nature kind of tucked away a little bit. We go there once in a while, but we've not done anything to get rid of the old nature. Now, do you know, if you walk in a hoarder's house, there's one characteristic that strikes you more than anything else. You know what it is? The smell. It stinks. Not to be indelicate about the matter, one of the men I had as a client had $5 million. He told us he did, and we couldn't believe it, because the house he lived in was just, you couldn't believe it. The cat dung on the sink was 6 inches thick. And that's where he prepared his meal. $5 million and lived in a place like that. Now, dear friends, do you see the parallel? The song that Bill plays so often for me, because I love it so much, How Rich I Am. We have all the riches of Christ, and yet we live in the dung of our old nature. How can that be? How can that possibly be? Practically, this means that we purposely stay away from certain things. That leads us into temptation. So if we're tempted to the donut house, we don't go there. Now, this includes people, places, things, thinking, and behavioral patterns. What we read, look at, and listen to. You don't feed the old nature. Now, I meant to tell you last time and I forgot, there is in the back table, I think they're still there, some review of the movie The Shack. Yeah, I picked it up last week. It is a piece of theological heresy, as the book is. I suspect some of you like it, and that scares me half to death. It's a blasphemous book. It takes the character of God and the picture of God that Scripture has given us and says, that's not good enough, so I'm going to create my own so we can make you feel better. You know what that is? That's idolatry. Ten Commandments says, do not make any image to look like God that's not me. That's what The Shack is. I hate that book. And now it's a movie, and many of you think it's the greatest thing since sliced bread. And if that's the case, you're hanging on to the old man. That's old man thinking. Now, if you're offended by that, you probably needed a shake-up. I want us to be people who understand what it is to be new creation people, not even the hint of anything about the old man. Number 5, Romans 8:13. So if you live according to the flesh, you'll be really happy. You will die. But if you live by the Spirit, you will put to death the flesh, and you will live. So what is living by the Spirit? Part of it means that we're putting to death the old nature. And we'll see a lot of the details of it in weeks coming. Colossians 3:5 says, put to death, therefore, whatever belongs to your earthly nature. I wonder where you're struggling. Do you ever see it as a struggle with the old nature? Do you realize the simplicity of what Scripture says? It says, put it off. Get rid of it. Make no allowances for it. Don't nurture it at all. Make no provision for the old nature. Matter of fact, put it to death. Number 6, take every thought captive to make it obedient to Christ. It all starts with the way we think. Now, we often try to change our behavior without realizing it starts in the mind. You know this old thing. Do you remember it when we were growing up? Our parents used to say this to us all the time. Plant a thought, reap a habit, continue a habit, and reap a character. You all heard that? No. You haven't heard that. That was such a prominent phrase when I was growing up. I can't believe you haven't heard that. It's really a great phrase. Let me give it to you one more time. Plant a thought. Let it stay there. Nurture it, water it, fertilize it. What are you going to do? You're going to reap a habit. Let the habit continue. What are you going to do? You're going to reap a character. James 1 puts it this way. Each person is tempted when he's, you catch this language? Dragged away by his own evil desire and enticed. He doesn't say like Flip Wilson said, the devil made me do it. Where does it come from? Do you see that? Dragged away by our own evil desire and enticed. Then after desire has conceived, it gives birth to sin, and sin, when it's fully developed, gives birth to death. Now, if you knew for sure that that thing that God told you to put off, that you still nurture in your hoarding house, was going to bring you to death, would you keep entertaining it? The problem is when you're dealing with a hoarder, they can't see that. I mean, it was almost beyond my comprehension when we'd go into a hoarder's house and have to clear it out. They wouldn't want us to throw anything away. We would have to take them out of the house and do something else, bring in a crew, take it all out, and then when they'd come back, they'd throw a huge tissy fit, much worse than that. But that's the only way we could get rid of the stuff. It was killing them. It was a fire hazard. It was unbelievable. But the only way we could get rid of it in their mind was to get them away. We do the same thing with our old nature, and it makes no sense whatsoever. The most important way to put off the old nature is to be made new in the attitude of your mind. Because you don't want it anymore. Why would you want an old, beat-up, stinking corpse around when God could give you new life? Do you see how Satan deceives us? We will never live in the victory of Christ until we replace the old with the new. The only way we can do this is to be made new in the attitude of our minds. We have to think differently about everything. And we're going to get to it in a couple of weeks, well after Easter. But one of these put-off, put-ons says, don't let any unwholesome talk come out of your mouth. I'm real tempted to do this. I'm not going to. I'm just really tempted to. But I don't do this. But I'd love to have a raise of hands to say who in this room did not have any unwholesome talk come out of their mouth this last week. I think most of us could not raise our hands. I'm sure most of us would have said sometime this week we've said something that is not wholesome. Now, are we satisfied with that? Or we're saying, God, no, that's not fitting to a new creation Christian. So what does God say? Stop having unwholesome talk. Instead, say what is helpful for others to build them up. So you stop yourself and you stop and think about, now wait a minute, is what coming out of my mouth helpful for those who are listening? You know the old phrase, open your a fool says everything. And so you keep your mouth shut, and when you open it, you remove any doubt that you are the fool, right? All right, God, so what does it look like for me in the attitude of my mind that's what's dictating what I say? This is the work of God through the Holy Spirit. The putting off and the putting off is our work. God is the one who gives us the new mind. We are the ones who act on it. Now, what we need to do with this new mind is what God's going to teach us in this passage. He's the giver of the new mind. It is our responsibility to use it. The idea here is continuous action, where God is continually renewing my mind every day. And one of the problems for us is that we try to renew our minds on Sunday and try to live on that all week long, and by the end of it, our minds are getting pretty weak. And so we have to come back and get pumped up again the next Sunday. God says, no, it's a continuous action that's going on all the time. We hinder the work of God because we don't renew our minds in the Lord every day. That is why we have made so much of taking every thought captive to make it obedient to Christ. And I don't know what it will take for you. There's all kinds of tools I use in my life. A lot of it is music. Music really speaks to me. Obviously, God's word speaks to me. Occasionally, Ruthie corrects me, and I love that when she does. God has given us a new mind, but what we do with it is our responsibility. And it is the wherewithal where the put off and put on takes place. So he says in Romans 12, 2, do not be conformed to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your minds. Then you'll be able to test and approve what God's will is good, pleasing, and perfect will. Now let me go back to my turning lane story a minute. For the person who's living as a new Christian, they would much rather give the blessing of God to the person who's in their way in front of them on the road, then speak badly of them. Can you relate to this? And part of it is to say, Lord, I don't want to just keep my mouth shut. I want to learn how to bless the person who's in my way. And that can be in so many different places. And I've already told you about the blood draw. You can either get upset because your agenda is not being fulfilled, or you can say, God, obviously you have another agenda here, and I can rest in it. Numbers 13, 26 to 33 says, it's talking about the children of Israel on the verge of going into the promised land. They've been in the wilderness for a short time, just came out of Egypt, and now they're going to look at the promised land that God says is already there. Let me say that again. This promised land was already theirs. The report of the spies when they came back. We went into the land which you sent us to, and it does flow with milk and honey. Duh. That's what God said it did. God said it flowed with milk and honey. They said, well, God told the truth. But then they came and say, we can't attack those people. They're stronger than we are. They spread among the Israelites a bad report. What's so amazing here is the people believe the bad report. Caleb silenced the people before Moses and said, we should go up and take possession of the land because we can certainly do it. Numbers 14, 7 and 9. The land we passed through and explored is exceedingly good. If the Lord is pleased with us, he will lead us into the land. Only do not rebel against the Lord and do not be afraid of the people, because we will devour them. What were they saying? They will devour us. Caleb and Joshua said, we will devour them. Why? Their protection is gone, but the Lord is with us. Are you living like that? Well, God said of Caleb, because my servant Caleb has a different spirit and thinks differently and falls with me wholeheartedly, I will bring him into the land he went to. Are we living in the land of the new creation Christian? Or are we living like the old self? Matthew 5:43 puts it this way. You've heard it said, love your neighbor and hate your enemy. I tell you, love your enemy and pray for those who persecute you, that you may be children of your heavenly Father in heaven. How's that gone this week? Are we living like old self or new self when it comes to this? And I trust, although I can't imagine there isn't, trust there would be nobody in this room who'd say, I could never forgive them. That's old creation thinking. Philippians 2, Paul says, do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. Rather, in humility, value others above yourselves. Oh, that's hard. value others above yourselves, not looking out for your own interest, but each of you for the interest of others. In your relationship with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus. Let the mind of Christ be in you. That's what Paul is saying to us here. He says, we've been given a new mind, and to put it into practice, we have to stop doing certain things. We're going to see a lot of them, and start doing other things. But the whole starting point is, are we acting out of that mind? Because we've been made new in the spirit of our minds, we have the desire to put off the old self and to put on the new nature. It's not ought. It's delightful desire. I want to do this because God's given me this new mind. It's not willpower, duty, defined, decision-driven kind of action here. It's a desire that God gives us. It's amazing to me that the Pharisees in Jesus' day were so concerned about the outside appearance, but Jesus said the inside was full of greed and lies. Paul is telling us here that the putting off and putting on are clear-cut choices we make. And the only way we'll be transformed is by making those choices, submitting to the inward work of the Holy Spirit. The reason I want to live in the light of the sovereignty of God at the blood draw experience is not because I ought to, because this is the desire of my life. Is it yours? Do you want to be able to say that, God, when you mess up my agenda, I'm perfectly satisfied with that because you've got a better one? When you take something away, child, spouse, job, health, you put in the blank, can I say, Lord, the Lord be blessed. The Lord has given. The Lord has taken away, as Job did. Philippians 3, 7 to 14. But whatever were gains to me, Paul says, I now consider loss for the sake of Christ. What is more, I consider everything a loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord. For whose sake I have lost all things, I consider them garbage, that I might gain Christ and be found in him. I want to know the power of the resurrection and participate in his sufferings, becoming like him in his death, so that I might attain to the resurrection of the dead. That's living like a new creation Christian. He says, I press on toward the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward. So the heart of the matter of putting off the old nature and putting on the new nature is a desire for God's fullness in my life. That is the treasure, and anything that would steal that treasure away is considered an enemy. May I suggest to you that in one sense, the battle with sin is very simple. And yet, we're just like Eve. Do you remember in the garden, God had said, Eve, Adam, here's how you're going to live with me. Here's this wonderful garden and my fellowship with you and all of that. And then Satan over here comes and he says, hey, Eve, wouldn't you like some of that fruit that God forbid? And by the way, God's a liar and he doesn't want any good for you. And so here's Eve, fruit, God, fruit, God. You know what Eve chose? Fruit. It's the same decision we've made every day this last week. Fruit, God. And you see, it's that simple. Paul says, if we have the new mind in Christ, if we are new creatures in Christ, what are we going to do? We're going to recognize the fruit is not worth it. The relationship with God is so much more profound. Well, here it is in music. Kyle, we're ready.
Sin when he found me.
Could never know anything about God. You couldn't believe, you couldn't see, you couldn't know his love for you. But now that you're a new creation Christian, all those things are yours. So how is it with your spirit? Are you trapped in the old man? The old woman? I've always hated those phrases when kids call their parents the old man, the old woman. I just think that's the most disrespectful thing you can say. But what an appropriate phrase to use what we were. We were the old man, the old woman. God has made us something new. Are you living in the love of God today? Are you enjoying being a new creation in Christ? Where you have the ability to know these things and practice these things and be done with the old and be living in the new. Heavenly Father, how I long for us these days as we're beginning to work through the details of this passage now, that you'd help us to understand what it is to put off the old and put on the new. I pray, Lord, that you'd help us to understand this attitude of the mind that you've given us is already ours. We don't have to do anything to get there. That's our possession. You've given us a new way to think. And I pray that that thinking would overrule everything else. Thank you that now we can see, we can believe, we can hear, we know the love of God. I pray as we leave this place, we'd be able to live in that love of God. And all the lies that would come at us from the outside, we would aggressively put them off. And in their place, to claim the promises of God who loved me, forgave me, who gave me new life. Lord, I pray as we leave this place that we'd be able to live in the reality of that throughout this whole week. And I ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.